Welcome back to another installment of Back to the Basics on Luther's Small Catechism. We continue our journey through the Ten Commandments. Tonight, as we wrap up our study of the Ten Commandments, I want to provide just a brief summary and review of everything that we've been talking about. You'll remember that the commandments were given in Exodus chapter 20, after the people of Israel had been freed from slavery in Egypt. And so the commandments, these Ten Commandments, were given to undergird the relationship between Adonai and Israel, between the God who orchestrated the Exodus and these newly freed slaves, Hebrew slaves, who were the chosen people of God. It's no secret that these commandments had expectations for behavior, first in relationship to God, and then second in relation to one another. You've noticed that cross shape. I've been mentioning that all summer. The first three commandments deal with that vertical relationship of faith, and the second is about our relationships to one another, to our neighbors, our families, our friends and strangers. In those first three commandments, the ancient stories of the ancestors, these ancient stories about God and the ancestors, were probably told around the fire. But this was a new generation of believers with a new and dramatic relationship to God, Adonai, the God of Israel. And so they learned that not only God wanted their undivided attention, you shall have no other gods, but also that God had chosen to be their God. I am the Lord your God, you shall have no other gods before me. And he wanted that relationship. And so just as they were crying out in Egypt under the bondage of slavery, God wanted to keep the lines of communication open through the gift of prayer. And so he commands that in the second in the proper use of his name. And then to prove that he was a gracious and merciful God, God called these former slaves into a practice of Sabbath, to a physical and a spiritual rest that only comes through taking a day off and hearing God's word. And then in the rest of the commandments, God deals with the horizontal relationships defined in the commandments 4 through 10. God makes decrees, and then Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount explains them, and Luther himself in his explanations hashes out the particulars around authority in commandment 4, the gift of life in commandment 5, marriage and families in commandment 6, property in commandment 7, and reputation in commandment 8. God puts all sorts of parameters, boundaries, and even fences of regulation around the very concrete callings of our life, the responsibilities that we have to one another, and the situations we find ourselves in over and over again in life. And it's clear that from Luther's explanation to these commandments, that there's some level of expectation for cooperation, or at least an attempt to comply with these things, that you will not kill, that you'll honor your mother and father, that you will not steal, and that you will not bear false witness against your neighbor. And then come the ninth and the tenth commandments. And I'd like to read them for you tonight. These are out of the Sola Catechism. The ninth commandment says, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. And the 10th commandment says, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, his workers, or his livestock, or anything that is your neighbor's. Let's take a listen now to what and how Luther explains this. The 9th commandment, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so that we do not plot to take our neighbor's possessions, inheritance, or home, or obtain them through deceptive means, but assist and serve our neighbors in keeping what is theirs. And then the 10th commandment, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, workers, livestock, or anything that is your neighbor's. What does this mean? We should fear and love God so that we do not ruin our neighbors' relationships with husband or wife, workers and livestock, or try to lure them away, but to encourage them to remain faithful and serve each other. Just an aside here about these explanations, you'll notice that Luther, 500 years ago, was sort of ahead of his time. It would have been understood most likely that spouse, particularly women, and slaves and livestock would have been property or possession. And Luther notices that and reclaims what God says in the commandments, that those are two separate things, that we have possessions and then we have relationships. And I think that that's really amazing that already in the scriptures and then again in Luther's explanations, that's uncovered or rediscovered. And gives us a sense of that in our own time. They're a good reminder for us. Well, having barred you from being your own God in the first commandment and from keeping you being the only authority or the sole authority of your life in commandment four, having pumped the brakes on robbing life and property from your neighbor and stopping you from sexual exploitation or ruining your neighbor's reputation, God now throws down another layer of protection for your neighbor and for you. The ninth and the tenth commandments attack not just behaviors or practices or even trespasses of boundaries, but actually attacks kind of the core of our sinful nature. The ninth and tenth commandments consume themselves with our consuming self-centered desire. We will look to our neighbor's possessions and immediately want what they have. We will look at our neighbor's relationships and we will wonder why we weren't so fortunate to have such special people and relationships in our lives. Covetousness, that coveting, is the old sinner's method of making us slaves again. To our selfish desires. It's sort of what the Hebrew slave said. Once they got out into the wilderness, they said, well, life was a lot better when we were in Egypt, you know, eating the flesh pots of Egypt. In fact, as Gerhard Ferdy and Jim Nestigan point out in their book, Free to Be, commercials underhandedly deceive you into thinking that you need a certain brand of something. They use a car, for example, a certain brand to be who you want to be, and then it will always lead you into wanting more. The next model comes out the following year. God knows that the sin of comparison will quickly rob us of the simple joy of enjoying life and all of the blessings that God gives. Covetousness makes us a slave to the worldly standards of success, of beauty, and recognition, and sets us up for a constant struggle to make our own way, to earn our place among the perceived giants of the earth, and strive for our perceived level of perfection. But all of this is based on our pretty questionable standards and not what God has done for us, providing us grace upon grace in the blessings of daily bread and salvation through his Son. To covet, to be told thou shalt not covet, and to finally admit that we do covet and fess up to that, is nothing other than to admit that we confess what we confess every week in the brief order of confession and forgiveness. We are in bondage. We are in a bondage to sin, sort of a power that holds us captive and we cannot free ourselves. We are in bondage to our inner desires and all the outer things that we see. And as my friend Ken Jones says, God's only response to that bondage is to give us commandments that hem us in and remove your choice. But when the Holy Spirit opens your heart, your eyes to God's will to bring you mercy in Christ Jesus and to put the law within your heart, then the blessings of the commandment grow. And the person of faith, that saint in you, is given only by God and will join God to gladly control and discipline the old outer person by stemming your desires and honestly helping you to pray, your will be done. Your will be done for my neighbor, your will be done for me, and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so we give thanks for these commandments that shape our vertical relationships, our horizontal relationships, and hem us in to be God's people as God sees fit to command us and to call us to be through the gospel. That's all for the commandments. Next week, we'll dive into the creed and its explanations and all of the rich blessings of the gospel of having God the Father, our creator, God Jesus the Son, our Redeemer, and God the Holy Spirit, our sanctifier and sustainer in the life of faith. Take good care, and we'll see you next week.